We continue as we live in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Bounteous God, you provide so much abundance in our lives. There is an abundance of grace, of love, of care, and of hope. Abundant Lord, please continue to provide for us such gifts of your nature, that we may be encouraged and strengthened to share in your gracious givings. As we gather to celebrate in a heartfelt giving of thanks and gratitude in recognition of your giving, may we be mindful, Lord, that there are still those around us and among us who do go without. Continue to strengthen us to do something about it in both giving and receiving. We do give you thanks and praise for all that you continually give in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For his sake, you have given forgiveness, mercy, grace, and eternal life to all who believe. Help our unbelief. Amen. We observe a moment of silence for reflection and self-examination. Most merciful God, we confess that in our sin we do not give you, our Lord, true thanks and gratitude. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways. To the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God in his mercy has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all of our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to us the entire forgiveness of all of our sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I ask that we now join together in praying the prayer for this Thanksgiving Day. Let us pray. Almighty and gracious Lord, we give you thanks for the fruits of the earth in their season and for the labors of those who harvest them. Make us, we pray, faithful stewards of your great bounty for the provision of our necessities and the relief of all who are in need, who live in our communities and throughout the world. To the glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. First lesson for Thanksgiving comes to us from the Old Testament book of Deuteronomy. It's the 8th chapter,
verses 7 through 18. Much of the book of Deuteronomy is Moses speaking to the people, preparing them to enter into the promised land. Even though he will not enter in, it is still he who prepares them to receive the promised land as gift and promise of God. And how do you respond to that? How, as God's people, in a covenant with a God who is going to give you a land and a life, how do you, as people, respond to that? To live in this blessing, in this calling, in this chosenness by God Almighty to be his people. What does that look like, and how do you go about being that? So much of that, again, rests in faith. To live by the faith that God will indeed care for you. Again, they had been in the wilderness, and there was no bread, and the Lord provided for them. Now, as they move into the promised land, I ask that you hear what God is going to fulfill, as he has indeed promised to them in these verses. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land with flowing streams, with springs and underground waters, welling up in valleys and hills, a land of wheat and barley, of vines and fig trees and pomegranates, a land of olives and honey, a land where you may eat bread without scarcity, where you will lack nothing, a land whose stones are iron and from whose hills you may mine copper. You shall eat your fill and bless the Lord your God with the good land that he has given you. Take care that you do not forget the Lord your God by failing to keep his commandments, his ordinances, and his statutes, which I am commanding you today. When you have eaten your fill and have built fine houses and live in them, and when your herds and flocks have multiplied and your silver and gold is multiplied and all that you have is multiplied, then do not exalt yourself, forgetting the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, who led you through the great and terrible wilderness, an arid wasteland with poisonous snakes and scorpions. He made water flow for you from flint rock and fed you in the wilderness with manna that your ancestors did not know, to humble you and to test you, and in the end, to do you good. Do not say to yourself, my power and the might of my own hand have gotten me this wealth. But remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you power to get wealth, so that he may confirm his covenant that he swore to your ancestors, as he is doing today. This ends our first lesson. Our gospel lesson comes to us from the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke. It is the 17th chapter, and its verse is 11 through 18. Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem. He is going to sacrifice himself as the Lord of all creation, so that we may be right with him. The removal of sin from this realm happens in this event, and then this event washes over us in God's grace. We get examples of how that washing over of God's grace, how that brings healing and restoration and salvation into our lives in this story. It's a story or a parable of 10 lepers who were healed by Jesus on his way to Jerusalem. And as they go off and are healed, only one comes back and returns to give praise and thanks to God Almighty. We hear this story. On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee. As he entered a village, 10 lepers approached him. Keeping their distance, they called out, saying, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. When he saw them, he said to them, go and show yourselves to the priests. And as they went, they were made clean. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. He prostrated himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. And he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus asked, were not 10 made clean? But the other 9, where are they? Was none of them found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner? Then he said to him, get up and go on your way. Your faith has made you well. This is the gospel of our Lord. Happy Thanksgiving. It's time for the children's message. And hopefully you are getting ready to have a meal and a special time or to have family if possible. And so I just wanted to share something with you about thankfulness and being thankful. It's getting to be that time of year, particularly as we begin to think about Christmas. And one of the things I loved about Christmas, of course, was receiving gifts. And from my aunts, my uncles, and from neighbors and things like that. Oh, it's always great to receive a gift like that. And the one thing I didn't like about that, though, is afterwards, my mom made us sit down and write thank you notes. I had to sit down and write 12 thank you notes. Oh my goodness. That was so hard. I wanted to go play. There was a whole bunch of other things I wanted to do. Plus, anyway, people gave me a gift. They know I'm grateful for it. Why do I have to write them a note? Oh my goodness. That was one of the things I just didn't like to do, was write thank you notes. And that's pretty selfish, isn't it? To give a gift or to receive a gift, I think it's just very natural, very Christ-like to offer a word of gratitude or thank you. And to write that to my grandma and my aunts that live far away, to write them a note was a good lesson to remember that we always thank not only our friends, our neighbors, our parents for the things we receive, even for people who may hold open a door for us. To say thank you is to be Christ-like. And for that, we just thank our Lord for this day, too, as we get to consider what it means to be a people who are thankful in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whose name we give thanks and praise. Amen. I hope you have a great day, and happy Thanksgiving to you all.
Of what the Lord has done. for us, give thanks. We give thanks. We give thanks.
Will you pray with me? God of all grace and God of all glory, we thank you for this time of reflection, this time of giving thanks. Consider what it means to give thanks, to be thankful, to have a thankful heart. We ask, Almighty Lord, that in this thankfulness we are able to continue to witness your grace, your love, and your life among us. Through Christ, in whose name we pray, amen. Grace and peace to you from our Lord and our Savior Jesus, who is the risen Christ of God, amen. You know, I've been thinking about this sermon for a little bit, or just this message for a little while. It's one of those where I was trying to create a story and think back on many of the Thanksgiving meals that we had when I was young, where we had a whole host of cousins and aunts and uncles and friends, and even with more recently with my family, with it's just been trying to think up of a story that would illustrate where my heart may be, and where perhaps you may find your heart as well, regarding the giving of thanks to God. It's almost natural, it seems, at times. And I was trying to come up with some, but you know what, it's the only thing that kept coming into my brain was, well, it's 2020. It's not really been the most, great year. It's been a tough year on many people. It's been a tough year on you. It's been a tough year on me. It's been 2020. Things certainly have changed in a way in which even this day we are going about it differently. We are going about it in a manner that is completely new to so many, most likely. Some of you may be saying, nothing new here. I spent Thanksgiving by myself for the last 5 years. And for you, I guess, to that extent, then you're prepared for this. But many have not been prepared for this. And it's just one of those things. I'm not saying that because it's 2020, we just sort of scowl at God and say, yeah, we're going to give thanks for. That's not the case by any means, and that's not where I'm going with this. 2020 has been a very interesting year, actually, and to many, many people, and including myself, and I'm sure for many of you as well. In many ways, there's been blessings. There's been blessings regarding this year, and it certainly has put us in a way of thinking differently. I know that as I read that lesson in Deuteronomy and all the things that the Lord was going to bless his people with water and food and abundance and materials and homes and all those things. And I certainly have collected many of those things over the years, as many of you have. But this year of 2020, it's been one in which I begin to reflect upon really what is all this stuff here. I noticed that it's a year in which we're more than willing to reflect upon that which is around us, and well, according to the rummage sale, we can certainly see how we don't need it all. Our rummage sales have been doing pretty good. You've been looking around and you go, it's not that I'm ungrateful that, you know, I received this gift, but you know what, it's been a part of my life and I can get rid of it. We sort of are in the midst of I don't want to say purging, but there are certainly things that we are more than willing to give up. We look around and we are more than willing to give over, or get, I don't want to say get rid, but just to give up that which is around us to a great extent. And in doing so, at the same time, not only have we been reflecting upon the things that we no longer need to hold on to, there are certainly reflections regarding to exactly what we do want to hold on to. Those things that really have meaning, things that have value. And we begin to realize that not a whole lot of things around us have as much value as relationships. Family, friends, gathering as God's people. It's very important. It's essential. In that we find ourselves still in a place in which it is difficult to gather. And that becomes very, very key and critical. We tend to have a heightened awareness about ourselves regarding those things which indeed do bring value, or we have assigned value, or maybe misassigned value. And we've been spending time this year reflecting upon the things that are very important and worth giving thanks for. In our lesson this day, there's these 10 lepers who are sort of, maybe you've been feeling like a leper, just isolating and unwilling to go out, or afraid that catching something or getting the COVID or sharing the COVID. We sort of are finding ourselves like these 10 lepers to a great extent, on the outskirts. And here comes this Christ along their way, their path, and they sort of collide there. And it is Jesus who says to them, go on your way. Go show you the priests. And in that going, they are healed. They're made well. They are able to re-enter into community. I guess they got the Jesus vaccination worked on them. God's grace washed over them. What did these people do? What did these 10 do? Did they give the right profession? Did the right confession? Say the right words? Did they sing the right hymn? Did they have the right amount of money? Did they have the right... No, they were the outskirts, outcasts. They had nothing really to offer to a great extent, Jesus. And it's just that pure grace that washes over them and brings healing. And it is this one who recognizes this grace that brought healing and saving. The word here in the end of that is that go, your faith has made you well. It's a sozo is in the Greek, which is also for salvation, for rightness, for wholeness, for well-being. It's associated with our spirit and our being. Very essence and core being made right with God. It's whole, it's complete, it's well. And this one finds us and is washed over in this grace. And what does it mean to live in this grace, to be touched by this grace? This one then goes and returns, and with a loud voice gives thanks and praise, because his life has been transformed, his life has been made well. His life has been made whole. It seems that when we are touched by God's grace, when we live in God's grace, in that story of in Deuteronomy, it's, well, what happens when you live in this promised land? This is what it's going to look like. This is what it should be. This is how it should be for you. Follow my commands. Follow this covenant. Live in the covenant by faith. And things will go well. And now this one who was a leper has been touched by God's grace, and he comes and gives thanks and praise. And it seems that as we are washed in this grace, one of the things that happens to us is that we are contained. We have now this incredible gratitude dwelling within us to give thanks and praise to God. And you'll note that when we give thanks to God, our whole being is lifted. It's changed. It's transformed. Have you ever noticed that? It's you could be moaning and complaining about anything in this world, which I'm sure happens every day, particularly in this year 2020. I've got a lot to moan about. I found myself griping and moaning quite a bit, particularly as an election year went on. I was moaning and griping about commercials, politicians, blah, 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 and it was just dragging me down, that whole attitude of being so critical and just, oh, it's, and then at one point you sit down to meal and you look at the food and you go, oh, just thank you, Lord, for this meal, thank you. And your whole spirit changes. You notice that? To give thanks is to be living in God's grace. It's a byproduct of God's grace. It's a fruit of God's grace. Generosity, thankfulness, gratitude, that comes with that grace that it washes over. How can it not? So when we are giving these thanks, we are saying, oh Lord, what you have given, I've received in love, by your love. It stirs love in me. It stirs your love in me. And all I can do is give that back with words of thanks and praise and gratitude. It's one of those things that when you give thanks, it used to be years back, well, centuries back, what that meant was I'm indebted to you. I'm in your debt. That's sort of the etymology of the whole word, but irregardless, when we give thanks and praise for our life and what is before us to God, we are in his debt. It is, and it's not because of being debtors, but it's because God's grace, that which is undeserved, that which comes to us freely out of God's love, can never be repaid, and we are always indebted to God's grace. And so to give thanks and praise is just a natural response, and it's a response that just brings life to us. It brings life to wherever we are. It brings life into the environment of which we are, of joy and peace and well-being. To live with gratitude and thankfulness is a calling. It's a gift. It's being chosen by God. And so this Thanksgiving Day, I hope as we give thanks, we truly do know that we are indebted to God and that he is very worthy of our thanks and our praise, this day and always, amen. Gracious Lord, we thank you for calling us, for choosing us, for washing us in your grace, giving us the faith to trust and believe that your love will never be taken from us. And in that, Almighty Lord, we have so much gratitude stirring within us. May we always give gratitude and thanks to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, in whose name we give thanks and praise always. Amen.
Lord Jesus, we continue our prayer, and we are ever mindful of those around the world who are not celebrating Thanksgiving and have little food to eat. We thank you so much for the ministry of the Liss family and how they are able to work with refugees and help them to sustain food and health and well-being for them and their families in a foreign land. Continue to bless them, Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we ask, Almighty Lord, that we are ever mindful of those in this nation who perhaps are not able to have food this day as much as we have around us. And we ask, Almighty Lord, that you hear our prayer and continue to keep our eyes and our minds alert and awake to how we may be able to help sustain and help to provide food for those who are lacking. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all in our congregation, Almighty Lord, who perhaps are alone watching this and have a TV meal before them. And we ask that you continue to bless them and keep, again, us alert to this. And may we be invitational in all that you have given us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. bless the food now that we are about to eat, as we see it before us on our tables and imagine it in our neighbors' homes. And we ask, Almighty Lord, that as we partake in dining and in feeding each other and eating with each other, that we are very aware of all that you have given us, especially our family, our friends, our faith, your grace, and your Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.